Dear friends, I am Dr. K. Kannan, Professor Mechanical Engineering, Anjali Ammal Mahalingam Engineering College, Koyilvanni. I am happy to meet you again in the video lecture on the subject Fluid Mechanics and Machines. And this is lecture number 2.2, second chapter, second lecture. We are discussing on pressure and its measurement. So in this lecture, we are going to discuss about the manometers and mechanical cages used for the pressure measurement. And in the earlier lecture, we introduced about the pressure, Pascal's law, hydrostatics law, and the atmosphere pressure, gauge pressure, absolute pressure, vacuum pressure, and the relationship between the three pressures we have discussed. And we studied about the simple manometer and the U-tube manometer. And here we take other types of manometer and mechanical gauges. So, the learning outcome to the students, at the end of the lecture, the student will be able to calculate the pressure using the manometers and explain the working of mechanical cages. So, in the earlier lecture, we studied about the U-tube manometer. Now, we take single column manometer. So, this is single column manometer where we have a large reservoir and a vertical glass tube connected to the pipeline where the pressure is to be measured. The single column manometer is a modified form of the U-tube manometer in which one column is converted into a reservoir of large cross-sectional area. So, due to the large cross-sectional area in the reservoir, for any variation of pressure, the change in the liquid level is negligibly small compared with the other column. So, hence the pressure is given by the height of the liquid column in the other column, liquid in the other column. So, it is a modification of the U-tube manometer. So, the left limb is converted into a reservoir. So, when there is change in the level of the liquid, it will be very, very small compared with the rise in the level of the other column. So, the height of the manometric fluid in this right side column that measures the pressure in the pipeline. So, there are two types of single column manometer. One is vertical single column manometer and inclined single column manometer. And this is vertical single column manometer. First, we discuss about the vertical single column manometer. How to measure the pressure using the vertical. We derive the equations to calculate the pressure, to determine the pressure using the single column manometer. Then, we take up the inclined single column manometer. And this is the construction. We have a reservoir and we have a pipeline and a glass tube. So, the left side is connected to the pipe where we want to measure the pressure. So, the pressure shown here is pressure at the center of the pipeline. And here we have the fluid in the pipeline is given by the dotted line. So, the height of the fluid above the XX is H1. The height of the manometric liquid is H2. And the difference in the level is X and difference in level of the level in the reservoir is delta H. Let the XX the datum line in the reservoir and the right limb of the manometer. When the pressure is connected, the manometer liquid in the reservoir pushed down by a small distance delta H. So, the delta H is small distance by which the manometer fluid is pushed down and will rise in the right limb. So, whatever the manometer fluid is pushed down, that is being lifted, that is being raised in the right side column. So, we take PA is the pressure in the pipeline, H1 is the height of the center above the XX, H2 is the rise of the manometric fluid in the right limb, A is the cross-sectional area of the reservoir, capital A is the cross-sectional area of the reservoir, and small a is the cross-sectional area of the right limb, rho1 is the density of the liquid in the pipeline, so the dotted line, and rho2 is the density of the manometric liquid. So, the manometric liquid, so it is rho2. For a fall of manometer liquid in the reservoir will cause a rise in the right limb. So, what is the fall? So, the fall A into delta H. So, cross-sectional area into delta H equal to small a into H2. So, small a is the cross-sectional area of the right limb and H2 is the height of the manometric fluid and delta H is the height of the fluid which is pushed down by the liquid. So, from this equation delta H equal to A into H2 divided by capital A. So, small a by capital A into H2. Now, consider the datum line YY. So, you have to take the datum line YY now. So, with reference to YY, we are going to measure the pressure. So, consider the datum line YY. The pressure in the right limb above YY. So rho 2 G into delta H plus H2. So look at here. So delta H is the height of the fluid in the pipeline, and H1 is the height of the fluid in the pipeline. So the pressure equal to rho 2 into G into delta H plus H2. And the pressure in the right limb of the YY equal to pressure in the left limb of the above YY equal to rho 1 into G into delta H plus H1 plus PA. So rho 2 is the density of the manometric fluid, delta H is the density, height pushed by the fluid, and H2 is the height of the manometric fluid. Then equating these pressures, we will get rho 2 G into delta H plus H2 equal to rho 1 G into delta H plus H1 plus PA. So rearranging, pressure in the pipeline PA equal to rho 2 G into delta H plus H2 minus rho 1 G into delta H plus H2. So we will get delta H into rho 2 G minus rho 1 G plus rho 2 G H2 minus rho 1 G H1. So substituting for delta H. So from the previous equation, we substitute for delta H. So delta H equal to A H2 by capital A, small a H2 by capital A into rho 2 G minus rho 1 G plus rho 2 G H2 minus rho 1 G H1. Now, the value of small a by capital A is very small and can be neglected. So, in this equation, a by a is very small and this can be neglected. So, finally, what is left out? Pressure in the pipeline A, PA equal to rho 2 G H2 minus rho 1 G H1. So, the two terms left out, rho 2 G H1 minus rho 1 G H2. So, that is the pressure. Now, when you have the inclined column manometer, the same manometer with how inclination, now the same principle we are going to adopt here to calculate the pressure. Now, the instrument is more sensitive because for a small depression, small level decrease in the mercury, manometric fluid will give larger rise in the fluid here in the inclined column. The distance moved by the manometer liquid in the inclined limb will be more even for a small pressure rise. So, the pressure in the pipeline at the point is measured by this equation. The same equation, PA equal to rho 2 G L into sin theta. So, the H2 is replaced by L into sin theta minus rho 1 G into H1. So, this equation you have to remember. So, suppose you are given a problem on the inclined single column manometer, this equation you have to remember. And the previous equation also you have to remember. So, PA equal to rho 2 G into H2 minus rho 1 G into H1 for the previous state single column manometer. For inclined single column manometer, this H2 is replaced by L sin theta, where theta is the inclination of the single column manometer with reference to the horizontal direction. Then the next is differential manometer. So differential manometer are used to measure the difference in the pressure at two different points or two different pipelines. So when I have two different pipelines, then we have to measure the difference in the pressure using the differential manometer. So, differential manometer consists of a U-tube with a manometer liquid, and the two ends of the U-tubes are connected to the points whose difference in pressure is to be measured. So, there are two types of U-tube differential manometer. One is U-tube differential manometer, another one is inverted U-tube differential manometer. So, we will see one by one. First, this is U-tube differential manometer. So, the left side arrangement, so look at the arrangement, this is the one pipeline A, this is pipeline B. So, the pressure difference between PA and PB is to be measured using the U-tube manometer. So, in the single U-tube manometer, the right side is open to the atmosphere. Now, the right side is also attached, connected to another pipeline. Now, we have to measure the difference in the pressure. So, PA minus PB, depending on the magnitude of the value PA minus. So, here we have to measure PA minus PB. Now, so this is one fluid flowing through the pipeline. This is another fluid. Now, we have a manometric liquid. Manometric liquid, we should have different specific gravity compared with the other two the fluids. Now, H is that. So, similarly, this is for, this is actually two different levels. So, the pipes are, pipelines are at two different levels. So, here the pipelines are the same elevation. So, this difference will give the difference in the calculation. So, you have to be carefully noted. So, depending on the arrangement of the pipeline, the pressure measurement, the magnitude or the equations for the pressure measurement will vary. Now, we take the terminologies. H is the difference in the mercury level in the U-tube. So this is the H in the mercury level. So XX is the datum level, datum point. Y actually, H is the difference in the mercury level in the U-tube. So the look at the H. Y is the distance of the center of B from the manometer liquid in the right limb. So this is from the mercury, the center of the pipe B, it is Y. So this distance is Y. X is the distance of center of A from the manometer liquid in the left limb. So here, so from this is the manometer level and this A distance is X. Rho 1 is the density of the liquid in the pipe A. Rho 2 is the density of the liquid in the pipe B. And rho g is the density of the manometer liquid. So this manometer liquid is rho g. Here it is rho 1 and it is rho 2. Taking datum line XX. XX is the reference. Now we are going to equate the pressure on the left side limb is equal to pressure on the right side limb. So if two points A and B are different level, pressure at the left limb above XX equal to rho 1 g into H plus X plus PA. So PA is the pressure in the pipeline. And this is the pressure due to the manometric fluid and the pipe liquid in the pipeline. Rho 1 g into H plus X plus PA. Pressure in the right limb of XX, rho g into H. Rho g is the density of the manometric fluid. G into H, height of the manometric fluid. Plus rho 2 g y. So rho 2 is the density of the fluid on the B pipeline B. G and Y is the height and PB is the pressure in the pipeline. Now these two are equal. Equating to these two pressure. So rho 1 G H plus X plus PA equal to rho G into G into H plus rho 2 into G into Y plus PB. So PA minus PB, the difference in the pressure between the pipeline A minus pipeline B, G H into rho G minus rho 1 plus rho 2 G Y minus rho 1 G X. Now we take one simplification. So if the two liquid point A and B are the same and density rho, if the liquid of at the point A and point B are the same with the density rho, that means rho 1 equal to rho 2. The two liquid, the pipeline A and pipeline B, suppose the same fluid is flowing through the pipeline A and pipeline B, then rho 1 equal to rho 2. So in that case, the equation is simplified. PA minus PB equal to G H into rho g minus rho plus rho g into y minus x. So this is the equation that you have to remember for your calculation. Suppose the pipeline A and B are the same level. So like the diagram what we shown here, when the pipeline A and B are the same level, so we have the height. So here the left side the pressure is PA plus x plus h and here PB plus x plus h. We have to find out the pressure on the left side and the pressure on the right side and left side and equate the two value. Suppose the two points A and B are the same level, pressure in the left limb above XY, XX, rho 1 G into H plus X plus PA. And similarly, pressure on the right side limb above XX, rho G into H plus rho 2 G into X plus PB. So there are two different fluids, rho G and the rho 2. Now equating these two, so rho 1 g into h plus x plus PA equal to rho g into h plus this is the pressure due to the mercury column, mercury fluid, I mean the manometric fluid, and this is the pressure due to the fluid on the pipe B and this is the pressure in the pipe B. So rho 2 g into x plus PB. Now PA minus PB equal to g into h into rho g minus rho 1 plus g into x into rho 2 minus rho 1. So this is the equation. Now we will simplify. When rho 1 equal to rho 2, if the liquid at the point A and B are same with density rho, then the second term is neglected. So PA minus PB equal to gh into rho g minus rho. So this is the pressure equation for the pressure to calculate the difference in pressure when the two pipelines are at equal level. So that you have to remember. Then inverted U-tube differential manometer. Now the look at the construction. The pipeline, the manometer arrangement is different from the previous one. So now the tube is vertical. Tube is above the manometric liquid is above the center of the pipeline. It consists of an inverted U-tube with a manometer liquid of density lesser than the density of the liquid in the pipeline. So, when the manometer liquid density should be lesser than the density of the fluid in the pipeline. If the two ends of the U-tube are connected to a point whose difference in pressure is to be measured. So, here we have to measure the difference in pressure PA and PB. So, look at the terminology. So, PA is the pressure at the point A, PB is the pressure at the point B, H1 is the height of the liquid in the left limb below the XX, H2 is the height of the liquid in the right limb below the XX, and H is the difference in level of the mercury, Rho1 is the density of the liquid in the left limb, Rho2 is the density of the liquid in the right limb, and Rho S is the density of the manometer liquid, Rho S or Rho G. Now, the pressure in the left limb, PA, minus, because the height is above the center of the A. So, PA minus Rho1G into H1. Pressure in the pipeline on the right limb, PB minus Rho2G into H2 minus Rho SG into H. Now, equating these two, we'll get PA minus Rho1G into H1 equal to PB minus Rho2G into H2 minus Rho SG into H. So, rearranging, so PA minus PB equal to Rho1 G H1 minus Rho2 G H2 minus Rho S G into H1. Then we take the mechanical gauges. So, mechanical gauges are defined as the device used for measuring the pressure by balancing the fluid column by spring or dead weight. So, U-tube manometer, they are giving very accurate pressure readings. So, actually using the U-tube manometer, we can measure the height of the column, then using the equations, we have to calculate the pressure. But mechanical gauges, they will directly indicate the pressure. So, there will be a scale in all mechanical gauges, the scale will directly read the pressure. For all industrial applications, we are using only mechanical gauges to read the pressure. For all industrial processes, like boiler, any industrial measurement, we are using mechanical gauges for reading the pressure, because immediately we will get the numerical information about the pressure. But for laboratory purpose, so to accurately calculate the pressure, we are using the manometer, because the manometer, the value given by the manometer are very accurate, and the calibration of the manometer is not required, whereas the mechanical gauges are to be periodically calibrated for its correctness. So, there are different types of mechanical gauges: diaphragm pressure gauge, Bowden tube pressure gauge, vacuum gauge. So, there are many more. So, you will be studying the more detailed pressure measurement in later stage in the subject called metrology and measurements. But here, we restrict with these three types of pressure gauges, mechanical gauges for fluid mechanics purpose: diaphragm pressure gauge, Bowden tube pressure gauge, and vacuum gauge. So, we take first the diaphragm gauge. So, look at the construction. And this is the screw. Using the screw, we are connecting to the pipeline where we want to measure the pressure. And we have a corrugated diaphragm. And in the diaphragm, we have a stem. We have a stem. And the stem, we have a box-like construction. So, the right side box, we have a rack. Toothed horizontal vertical surface. On the rack, we have a pinion. So, when the rack slides, the pinion will rotate. On the center of the pinion, we have a needle. So, when the pinion rotates, the needle will move. So, on the needle will be moving on the scale. So, here we have a scale. On the scale, we can read the pressure. So, the pressure will be marked on the scale. So, it is calibrated to the pressure. We can directly measure the pressure. So, we have a body of the diaphragm gauge, you have a corrugated diaphragm, and one side of the diaphragm we have a stem, we have a stem. So, here we are connected with the rack, and we have a pinion, at the center we have a needle. Now, how it works? What is the diaphragm gauge? Employs a metallic diaphragm as sensing and actuating device. So, the metallic corrugated diaphragm is a sensing, it is sensing the pressure, also actuating the device. When the pressure applied on the lower side of the diaphragm, So we apply the pressure. So the pressure is connected to the lower side of the diaphragm. So the pressure is acting on the lower side. Now when the pressure is acting on the lower side of the diaphragm, what will happen? The diaphragm will deflect in the upward direction. Diaphragm will deflect in the upward direction. So the upward deflection will actuate the rack. The rack will be moving in the upward direction and the pinion will be rotating. When the pinion is rotating, the needle is moving on the scale to show the pressure. This upward movement of the diaphragm is transmitted by the rack and the pinion mechanism. So the pinion is attached to the spindle of a needle, moves on the graduated dial, which is graduated in suitable scale to measure the pressure. So this is a simple pressure measuring instrument, pressure measuring device to indicate the directly the pressure. So this is next one is Bowden pressure gauge. So these are all the commercially available Bowden pressure gauge. Look at the scale. So here the pressure is indicated in bar. Here the pressure is indicated in megapascal. Here is the pressure is indicated in the kilopascal and the PSI. So PSI is the pounds per square inch. So this dial is very popular, and in all the the air filling, we are filling the air in the tubes of our two-wheeler automobile. So they are measured in terms of PSI, pounds per square inch. We fill the tire with the number 28 PSI, 38 PSI, 32 PSI, 35 PSI, like that. So the number is PSI, pounds per square inch. So it is a British unit for measuring the pressure. Normally in a SI system we use the kilopascal or the bar for measuring the pressure, but still we are using PSI, pounds per square inch, for some industrial practice. So the construction of the Bowden pressure gauge. So we have a pressure net inlet. So here this nut is connected to the pipeline where you want to pressure, measure the pressure, and you have a tube. So here we have a block, and then the air is flowing to through the inside of the tube. So this tube is a flat tube, and this is called this cross section is called as elliptical. So this is the cross section of the tube, and this tube is made by majority of the cases the tube is made by copper. And this is called as Bowden tube. And the end of the Bowden tube, you have a link. This link is connected to the pivot. So this is the gear sector, and here we have a fixed pivot. And as usual, we have a pinion, and then center of the pinion, we have a needle or pointer which is moving on the scale. So this is the inlet of the liquid. The fluid is flowing through the pipeline and through inside the Bowden tube, and here we have the link connecting the end of the Bowden tube with the gear sector, and then the gear sector, top of the gear sector, we have a pinion and we have a pointer which is moving on the graduated scale. So how this is working, we will see this diagram. So you take this diagram. So Bowden pressure gauge, so the fluid is entering here, it is flowing through the pipeline. So as we said earlier diagram, so this is of elliptical cross section. So the tube is of elliptical cross section. So because of the pressure, so outside the elliptical tube, the atmospheric pressure is acting. Inside the elliptical tube, the pressure of the fluid is acting. Because of the difference in the pressure, the elliptical tube will try to become circular. When this is trying to circular, change its shape. When it is trying to change its shape, the tip of the Bowden tube is moving away. When this moving away, and this link will be moving in the upward direction. As the link is moving in the upward direction, the sector is moving in the opposite direction. When the sector is moving in the opposite direction, the pointer will be rotating in the clockwise direction. So the pinion will be moving in the clockwise direction, and the pointer will be moving on the scale to indicate the pressure. So you look at the mechanism, how it is working. So the fluid is entering here, flowing through the elliptical tube. Because of the pressure difference between the fluid pressure inside the Bowden tube and the atmospheric pressure outside, it will try to change its shape. In the action of changing its shape, so the tip of the Bowden tube will move in the upper direction, which actuates the link to move in the upper direction, and the sector to move in the opposite direction, and the pinion to rotate in the clockwise direction, then the pointer is moving on the scale to to indicate the pressure. So this is the Bowden tube pressure gauge, and this is very popular and it is very very important for any mechanical engineering student, because all the pressure whatever is given in our calculation, it is measured using the Bowden pressure gauge. So Bowden pressure gauge is the basic device for measuring the pressure for any mechanical engineering student. And the Bowden pressure gauge is used to measure the high pressure as well as low pressure. So the Bowden pressure gauge consists of a metal tube, rack and the pinion and a pointer. The metal tube is made by bronze for low pressure, nickel for high pressure. So copper is also material used earlier. Now we can take bronze and the nickel for high pressure. The metal tube has elliptical cross section and it is bent in the form of a segment of a circle and respond to the pressure change. One end of the tube is connected to the source pressure and the other end is connected to the rack and the suitable levers. When the pressure is applied inside the tube, the internal pressure causes the tube to expand and make other end to move, and in turn make the rack rotate on the pinion. So the pointer attached to the pinion moves on the dial, which is graduated with the suitable scale to measure the pressure. And the next is vacuum gauge, and this is the vacuum gauge. Look at the dial, the similar type of pressure gauge we are using, but it is in millimeter of mercury. So the value, look at here, 0 to -760. So it is measuring negative pressure, vacuum pressure, negative pressure. Vacuum gauge are used to measure the negative pressure, that is pressure lower than the atmospheric pressure. Vacuum gauges are graduated in millimeter of mercury below the atmospheric pressure. So Bowden gauges are used to measure the vacuum with a slight change in the design. So the scale is rearranged. In vacuum gauges, the tube is bent inward instead of outward as in the other pressure gauges. So vacuum gauges are used to measure the vacuum in the condenser. So in mechanical engineering, in the steam power plant, condenser is the important device which is operating on the negative pressure or the vacuum pressure. So that you will be studying detail in other mechanical engineering subject, condenser in thermal engineering. So in the condenser, the vacuum pressure is maintained, and using to measure the pressure in the condenser, we are using the vacuum gauges. And we stop here, and these are all the books I published earlier. Design of transmission system, turbo machines, heat and mass transfer, operations research, gas dynamics and jet propulsion, thermal engineering, fluid mechanics and machinery. This fluid mechanics and machinery book, you can refer to it for more information and problem in the fluid mechanics subject. And I have a YouTube channel where I upload the video lectures on the all the subjects mentioned here, and the solution for the gate question paper are also uploaded. You can refer to it for better learning and to pass in the gate examination. And thank you for watching. So you please post your comments on the comments box, and you subscribe the channel so that you will get the updated video on the subject. And you can contact me to my mail ID or WhatsApp number for any clarification on the subject. So we'll meet again with additional other video on the fluid mechanics subject. Thank you once again.